Hi, welcome to Shrinks on the Street podcast. Today's topic, discipline. I am your host, M. Gary Neuman, with my wise co-host and daughter, Esther Neuman Halprin. We have a private practice in Miami. Please go to NeumanMethod.com, NeumanMethod.com. Find out more about our work with Oprah, New York Times best-selling work, and other projects we have to offer you in the community. So, Esther, here we are. We wanted to cover discipline, and because it's so important to talk about practicality, because I think a lot of people, when it comes to discipline, they hear a lot about theory, which is very important. We put out the call to people to tell us some of their problems and what are some of the issues that they have with their kids. And we have a very healthy list more that we could outline here with people saying,
we're
going
to get to some of them. We're going to get to as many as we can.
So what I want you to do first is let's go through some of the examples. And we're not going to answer them right now, but let's just to get everybody out there to know we're going to deal with the practical questions that you want to know.
And I think these are practical situations that many of you parents out there deal with on a day-to-day basis. So we really want to
try to pick the ones that apply to as many people as possible. So if this is happening to you, obviously, don't feel like it's peculiar because other people have written in about it. So that's the story. So what was the first one?
Okay. So the first one was your three-year-old or whatever young age child throws a ball, and it's very classic, and breaks a window in the house.
Yes.
You know? So that's like that's like a very common one. Happens to every parent. So after we get through our examples, we'll get to your our theory on how to manage
We had one about a child, a toddler, who was on the playground. And the mother wrote to us that she was mortified because her little toddler, when she looked up, had a friend's hair, you know, in both of her hands, you know, and she didn't know what to do. Like, you know, am I supposed to go over and, you know, smack my child or how much do I apologize? Like, what do you do? So that was one that happens. You know, you feel very responsible. Your kid's in a playground and, you know, hits some kid or pushes them down. Like, you know, what's supposed to happen. So that was one.
Another one we had was, and this is, I think, almost every parent probably has had this, where like your four-year-old runs into the street, you know, for that second. And even if a car is not by, you are like, you know, because what if a car was there? And and the reaction is so instinctual.
And how do you,
You know, it's very instinctual
to that. How do you teach that moment, right? Yeah. Because that's not one you want to just, you know, be all pleasant dilly-dally about.
Like, oh, honey, it's fine. No, it's not fine. You can't run into the street.
The Mack truck is coming.
Oh, the Mack truck will see you. Don't worry. So we want to protect children.
We had one about, 10-year-old. It happened to be a 10-year-old, but any kid who lies about their homework.
Yeah, you know, that happens a lot.
Yeah, exactly. You find out after the fact. I've been doing homework for a while, so
get that teacher calling you like, oh, actually, we haven't, you know, received the homework.
We had another one.
How have they been doing?
We had another one. This one was very specific, but we'll clean it up, the language. But anyway, that their 11-year-old called her pathetic. Like, basically, when they got into it, this 11-year-old,
kids have a...
really went for the jugular and... It was so, so upsetting. Yeah. So we're going to talk about that.
Yeah. We had another one where, you know, the 16-year-old, where she lied about where she was that evening. She said, you know, I'm going to a friend's house. And she was really not at her friend's house, you know, and that's scary, I think, for a lot of parents. And again, these moments are, they are teachable moments, but they're very, you know, they can be scary. You need to know where your child is, you know, a 16-year-old girl who's saying, also that she's saying she's at one place and not in that place.
Yes.
You know, that's a little frightening.
And here's the point. It's frightening, but it's not peculiar. That 16-year-old isn't like, oh my gosh, my 16-year-old is messed up.
No.
It's really not. Kids... teenagers, especially 16, I guess that's the age at a lot of states you can start driving, and all of a sudden you can start looking at that freedom. So it is something common.
I think it's the line. I think where it becomes an issue is where you want to, when your child becomes 16, I think where a lot of parents get hurt is that your child is 16 and they're lying about where they are.
Right.
And I think that is something, and it is normal. I think every teenager
does. Well, we talked about lying.
Yes. If you want, go to our podcast. Yes. We have a whole section on lying, detector
and
tests.
And you'll feel better about your 16-year-old lying because you'll realize how much we as adults lie. So it's not so unusual.
Yeah, no, it's not unusual, but I think as a parent, I've had a lot of parents who come to me like, oh, they didn't tell me where they were, and I'll speak to the teenager who's my client, and they'll be like, well, if I told them, then they wouldn't let me go to the mall, you know? So they wouldn't let me go late at night. night, you know, out with my friends to wherever, you know, they're going.
Very simple reasoning.
So actually it is logical. But so I guess the question we're going to help you do is merge that relationship. The parent need to keep your child safe, even when they're getting to be a little bit of more of an adult, and helping the child be feel comfortable sharing where they're going.
Right. Even if it's normal, you still, because you have the responsibility, and now they're 16, you know, more and more bad things can happen.
And it's more responsible not lie, you know, teaching your teenager, you know. Yeah. Okay. So let's move.
Then we had an 18-year-old or above. I could see happening, but where they use the credit card without permission. And that's something that we have to talk about. It's funny because I think that you say 18-year-olds, 10-year-olds. Yeah. I mean, nowadays, like during COVID,
Amazon stuff. I don't know that you have a little 8-year-old saying, I don't know how that toy got here. I have no idea how that new Switch got here.
His little kid was ordering stuff, not really knowing that, you know, it really meant a lot of money. Just, you know, they were going to the account and ordering great stuff for themselves.
Well, my kid,
fantastic.
Grandma buys a lot of toys for my son, as she should.
Yeah, but my wife is on Amazon with my 3-year-old grandson, your son, just going through, would you like that?
So and he's my like, kid has no idea now. Right, he has no idea. He'll come to me and he showed me a cartoon. He's like, I want that. I'm like, Daniel, I can't get that. That doesn't exist in toy form. And he's like, no, trust me. We'll get it. And he talks it. It's really cute.
So these and others are going to be the issues that we're going to be dealing with from a practical standpoint. Right. So by the time we finish, you know, part 2 or part 10 on discipline, we will get to these.
And my final one, which I love that someone wrote into, was that their 27-year-old adult child.
Uh-oh.
Yes, and I've never done this, I don't think, but you can tell me.
I won't say it in this forum.
We'll talk about that later, okay? Where the 27-year-old was taken away on a wonderful vacation for Hanukkah with their little children and, you know, the grandparents, something,
or Christmas.
You know, or Christmas. Any holiday.
Whatever holiday it is.
So we're taken away and we're not thankful. We're not very appreciative of the parent.
Oh my gosh.
You know.
This is an interesting question.
The holidays come around, you know,
we always, part of a podcast is diverting, I guess, but like, you know, this is a good question. So if you go to your parents or your in-laws, you know, for dinner or for a weekend, do you bring a present to say thank you? See, most kids, I think, probably think, no, I'm going to my parents, you know? And maybe the in-law, the daughter-in-law or son-in-law says, no, we should bring something. But it's like, you know.
Or thank you notes. I found this to be something, you know, where I'll say, oh, you know, to my husband, my in-laws got a gift for whoever. And I say, oh, let's write a little note. And my husband will be like, why are we writing a note to my parents?
Right.
You know, because I think as the child, you're still a child in some way.
Yes.
You feel like a child. You feel like it's coming to you. You feel like your parents should be taking you away on vacation because they did for the last 20 years. But now you are an adult.
Write in and tell us, because I want to see what happens. And I want to see if it's all the older generation that says yes. And the younger generation says, what are you talking about? I don't know. We'll see.
So that's going to be, that's a good one. Okay.
Let's get to, let's backtrack now.
Okay.
And first let's talk about some of the statistics that really got us to talk about discipline. Yeah. And also remember that I recently wrote a book that you can get for free.
Yeah.
Free.
Free download.
Totally. Free download. Go to NeumanMethod.com. Free download. Listen, discipline, and respect. The only three techniques you need to be a great parent. And we talk about discipline in there as well. But some of the things that really made us focus on this was some of the statistics that are going on nowadays. Yeah. So depression, we know, is up. And the use of antidepressants are also, and anxiety medication are way up. That, you know, before COVID, obviously during COVID that happened, understandably. So clearly it's harder for people, adults, to deal with life. And that's why we're talking about discipline in the concept of also teaching self-discipline, how to be able to manage life.
Yes, I think that's an important thing. We want to, you know, and this is what we're kind of going to talk about, is how to discipline your children where it becomes a way of helping them deal with the struggles and stressors of life. And that that starts when they're little at home. One of the statistics I found very interesting in the New York Times was that on college campuses, 51% young adults went for counseling for anxiety, wow. 41% for depression, wow. and 34% dealing with relationship issues. And finally, 20% went for suicidal ideation.
Wow, 20%.
20%, that's 20 out of 100, right?
Wow, exactly.
I'm not good at math either,
so you got it from me, so you're talking to the wrong, blindly in the wrong.
I got married to a math guy, and I gave up. I was like, I just rely on him for any mathematical calculation.
That's funny, that's my wife speaks Spanish. So I live in South Florida, and I never learned Spanish because she's like my voice. So once your spouse is very good at something, you just kind of I love relying on them for that. And then you don't get any better at it. That's the issue. But I do want to mention to all of you that suicide ideation is not just like suicidal thought many people have, like, oh my God, I'm going to kill myself. It's like they really, it means they're thinking it through.
They're planning it out. They're thinking, should I take pills? Should I cut myself?
So that's intense. To think that 20%, that's pretty unfortunate.
Right.
You know, in the last 10 years, hospital admissions for suicide teens has gone up. And here's one that I'm going to read exactly because I thought it was so interesting. The National Institute of Health said that 1/3 of adolescents suffer from an anxiety disorder. Okay, so that's 33 out of 100, right? From anxiety disorder.
That's diagnosable.
Yeah. In 1985, UCLA began asking incoming freshmen if they, quote, felt overwhelmed by all I had to do. And in 1985, 18% said, I felt overwhelmed by all I have to do.
Yeah.
But recently, that number went up to 41%.
Wow.
So it's really that difference that started to speak to us and say, wow, something is changing, that nowadays, kids, teens, and beyond are having more difficulty, more anxiety, more depression about living life.
Yeah.
And does that mean that somewhere in their childhood, they're not getting the tools by which to live life and deal with life's challenges and complications?
Yeah, I think that's pretty, very accurate. And that study, I do believe, even in my own private practice, in the last few years, I've seen a tremendous increase in teens and kids who come to me for anxiety, and have real anxiety focused issues, as opposed to maybe 8 years ago they would have still come to me for different kind of issues. But right now it's a very big focus on anxiety.
Yeah.
And it is curious why we're all, from kids, little kids are having this tremendous anxiety.
Something's going on. Actually, we're going to, in the future, we're going to have Dr. Harold Koplowitz from Child Mind Institute. We're looking forward to meeting with him. He is a giant in the field of psychiatry for children. And we're going to ask him some of those questions. Like, I'm really curious if he feels that life or school has changed with the way the world is today. Has it made it more difficult for children than in 1985? Or is it just that, as parents, we're not doing the job that we could be doing to prepare them? I don't know. One scary statistic I will say we got was from USA Today, that between 2006 and 2016, suicide for children ages 10 to 17 has gone up 70%. 70%. I want to mention something, again, a little diversion here, but I do want to mention to all parents out there, and maybe in the future we'll do something about suicide because it's such an important topic. But I have found in my practice that teens and beyond, 20-year-olds, an interesting time you should always be careful about suicide is when they get dumped or they have a big breakup. It's very interesting. We find, I don't know the statistics, I'm just saying this anecdotally, that from what I've heard and from what I've learned and from what I've seen, that a lot of times you could have a kid who, could be happy, depressed, whatever, but it's when they get dumped by a boyfriend or girlfriend and they feel like the world is over. And it's those few days. So
even if the relationship, for us, if you've been married for a long time, the relationship could be 3 months for teenagers.
Right, exactly.
And three years, 3 months is like, the world.
It could mean so much acceptance and approval.
Yeah, and love. love, right, approval, and they're looking for that approval and social approval, and so that could be, you know.
Yeah. So I just, as a side note, any parent out there, if their child does go through a breakup when they're young,
be aware.
Yeah, watch them for a few days. You know, just be on top of them. You know their whereabouts. Make sure you're talking to them and talking them through it. You know, and you know, so that's one part. So before getting into some of the details, I did want to bring up an interesting thing that people always talk about, and that is a trophy for every child.
I love it. Yeah, this is a big topic.
People
this
always
is a great topic.
And sometimes people like throw it out like, oh, giving trophy to every child. You know, I mean, it's like always said in that like upset, angry way. Like in my day when we were young,
we didn't have any trophies.
Exactly.
We went to school uphill both ways.
If you wanted a trophy, you had to build a trophy from clay.
To chisel it. Like Michelangelo, you know, like the David.
But the question is, when I was young, in my generation, you only got a trophy if you won in the league, if you were the champions. No one else got a trophy that I remember. And in your day, as you grew, and I don't know, there's 23 or 4 years between us, you already came into it with your siblings. You have 4 brothers.
Yeah.
Where everyone, I mean, you went to the assembly.
Oh, my
God.
And
I remember looking up the first time this happened. I remember looking up and saying, oh, my, like, how big was the championship team? There's like 300. Was it 300 people on the championship? That's why they won. They had so many more people playing in the field. Like, what's going on? Until I realized, oh, hello.
It's a trophy for every kid.
It's for everybody.
No, but it's not only that. It's that you have 4 boys. I'm one of 5. Yes. I'm the only girl within 4 boys. So, 4 boys, and again, my math skills need some help, but each of them played, you know, 3 sports a season, right? They do basketball, football, soccer, and each of them would get trophies. So what's, you know, 4 times 3, which is...
It's 12.
12, thank you.
Yes.
12
each
trophies
year.
Each year.
They had like 40, 50 trophies.
I mean, they're getting it till they're
whatever.
17 at least.
Yeah, that's, yeah, exactly. Right.
Feel like a lot of trophies.
So it's interesting because one thing it almost, I think it did, was that I think they only... Even in their minds, they came to appreciate the trophies when they were on the winning team.
Yeah. Yeah,
like even for them, there's this kind of idea like
trophies
where they knew it was kind of given.
Yeah, because I remember when they won the championships.
Yeah,
and
that
it would
trophy
be like,
they kept.
Oh my God, you know.
But I don't know if the other trophies
they
followed
it.
Them so much from place to place.
It is interesting because the sports I used to do, we didn't get a trophy for each person. It was
Yeah. This is interesting.
They didn't catch up with the 90s. You know,
what is that about?
I don't know. You know, so I did. Equestrian, equestrian, horseback
jumping,
riding, horse jumping.
4 feet, by the way. Let me tell you don't want to be a parent watching your little girl jump 4 feet.
Just
don't go.
After I took up this sport,
forget about it.
My doctor told me, he said it was the second highest sport where there was a life-altering injury.
Yes.
After basically like cliff diving, you know, you had...
Horse jumping. Yeah.
Which I didn't know at the time, which I think,
exactly.
you know,
but,
why you
but
let
you
me
know
do
know something
it.
What's really great. If you want to be a into prayer, this is the sport. Sign your kid up for horse jumping. Watch them tie their legs to the what the
oh yeah
what
yeah
was
that wasn't
on?
That was really bad.
I don't think this is allowed.
It wasn't really allowed.
I didn't know about
I didn't,
it.
Right.
Trust me.
I didn't know at the time. My instructor would tie my stirrups, you know, the things you put your feet in, to the horse, basically.
And
so that way it would train me to keep my legs down. Now, I later learned
that... But your legs were tied into it?
Yes. Yeah, so if I fell, God forbid, I would...
You couldn't fall off the horse,
break
basically.
Break everything, basically.
So. Brilliant. Brilliant.
It was tough. We were tough going. And I didn't get a token trophy. So you can see the sport
needless to say. They don't give out ribbons.
No, they didn't give out ribbons.
Just for entering.
Yes. And ice skating also. That was the other sport. So maybe because everyone was very, you know, Olympic driven or, you know, it was very... It's very
I
serious.
Guess. When you get to those competitions, maybe you're already
yeah,
in
maybe
a
everyone
mindset
took it.
That nobody wants it unless you
But the
you
truth
really
is,
win.
On you know, on the my brother's teams, there were some, you know, sports celebrities' kids there.
That's
and
true.
They
terrific.
Got, you know.
Watching them was amazing. I would remember watching
flag
football.
Oh, my God, it was
football.
So much fun.
These 11-year-olds, it was like watching
not
a professional
the,
game.
Yeah,
they
not,
were amazing.
Not to knock the Dolphins, you know, but at the time,
they
weren't they so
weren't
great.
Good.
So the flag foot, my brother's flag
it
football
was much more exciting. I think the skill set was a little higher.
No.
Well, now you're worried about insulting Miami Dolphin players?
I worry about insulting anybody.
It's okay. It's all right. They're
tough. They can
they're
take
tough.
It.
Yeah,
they can take
their
it.
Their egos are still
Are you
in
sure?
Because
they got trophies every, you know,
exactly.
when they were kids.
So
back
listen,
to the trophy. We digress.
Trophy.
Okay.
Here's my thought. because I don't think it's easy enough to say we should go back in time and there should be no trophies for anybody.
No.
And here's really where I learned it. I really wasn't sure about it. And then last year, I jogged marathons. And when I say I jog marathons, it's more like a saunter now. It's more like exactly. I kind of meander.
Look,
you know what I'm
scenery.
Saying? Just look at the scenery. You know, I always joke, you know, I mean, you know, somebody once told me when I was trying to get to jog more past like 5 and 6 miles, because you're talking about, you know, 26.1.
Yeah, I couldn't do it.
But anyway, I remember you told me, you're supposed to eat, you know, on the jog, you know. And I always joked with him when I went back to him. I always said, you know, I fooled with him and I said, you know, you should never tell a Jewish person to eat on a jog, because there I am with my corned beef sandwich. Well, everybody else is like just eating like sugar sticks and jelly beans. You know what I'm saying? I was the only guy who ran a jog 26 miles and I gained weight. But I would like be eating like, you know, candy bar. I don't know. I just had in my mind like, hey, I'm jogging. You told me not to put sugar in my body. Nowadays, they have a lot better, you know, gels and stuff and things like that. But anyway, so, you know, if you don't know about marathons, you pay and you get these T-shirts, and at the end you get these medals. You know, you run through and you get, someone puts a medal, you know, a ribbon, you know, like an Olympic medal over your head, and you feel amazing. And then, so last year in one of the ones that I ran, they came out with something that the mail messed up, and you're not getting your actual medal. You're just getting a fake medal and like a, you know, a crappy plastic one, and we'll send you the one in the mail. If I tell you that, like, thousands of people walking around like crestfallen, like, I don't know. I mean, like, am I going to be able to make it through the marathon if I'm not getting my real big, you should see these big, beautiful, shiny medals they
make.
And I realize that, you know, it's kind of funny because, you know, you pay for these medals,
right.
You know what I'm saying? And then when you get them, my kids, God bless all of you, you know, you kind of joke, oh, you got the medal. Oh, did you come in first? Did you come in second? Third? No, I came in 10,000 out of 20,000. I'm very proud to be in the middle. But like, oh my gosh, as adults, we want that medal so much.
Feel
just
good.
For participating, you know?
Yeah.
And I know, and I even paid for the medal, you know?
Yeah.
So I think that it is good to encourage kids. And I kind of changed my mind and thought, you know, maybe every kid should get a trophy.
Right.
The only difference I would say is I think the championship team should get like a trophy double in size.
Yeah.
They should at least see that there is something different. If you win, whether you might have worked just as hard, but still the world will reward, you know, greater skill.
Right. And I think, and this comes to our first point about discipline, which is you're a teacher.
Yes.
You know, you are a teacher. So you, with discipline, you know, yes, you're caught up in the moment and we sometimes react to the situation. However, we have to remember and take a step back that we are the teachers. So what are we teaching our child when we're disciplining? So in that situation, you know, we want to think, okay, if we give them a trophy, we are teaching them, wow, you know, you worked hard, you get this. But if the trophy for the championship is the same, then what are they, we're not teaching them to work towards anything. You're going to get the same reward, as opposed to if you have a bigger trophy or a bigger prize.
Right.
You know, maybe you can instill in them this idea, this concept that, oh, wait, if I work even harder, there's something more I could achieve, and I'll get rewarded for it. And it's kind of like at work. I mean, we have this all the time at work. You know, you get a bonus. You know, you get your salary for, you get paid for doing
what you're supposed to do.
Yeah, doing what you're supposed to do.
Now you want a bonus?
Yeah.
You want me to say
to
you,
why
oh,
you
good job. You want
you're doing
employee
what you're
of the month?
Right.
You could say, what are you talking about?
Even gift cards. Like, it's so, like, you know, a lot of offices give out gift cards. And people are so excited because
that extra.
We're happy. We feel appreciated. And we spoke about this in another video cast and podcast with marriage, you know, appreciating, you know, spouse.
Right.
And I think we all want to feel appreciated.
Even for the things that we are supposed to do.
Exactly.
Right? So if a kid, you know, plays, you know, hard in a league, does his or her homework, does well at school, whatever it is, you know, okay, it's what you're supposed to do. And part of it, I guess, people want to teach is to have an internal feeling of success. We do want to get there. But remember, you don't get there when you're necessarily 5 and 10 and 15. Giving a little extra feeds that model. So you don't want to feed it so much that the only reason I'll do what I'm supposed to do is to get all the good goodies. Yeah. I want to have an internal sense of success, but you do want to feed it to some extent.
Yeah.
And I think,
yeah, you know, that's why we have, you know, there's a concept I think a lot of parents know out there, but to your point, you know, when a little kid comes to you and says, I made this beautiful, you know, I made a piece of art.
Right.
You're not, as a parent, supposed to say, oh my God, that's the best thing in the world. Let's hang it up in the refrigerator. Oh my God, oh my God. You're supposed to, if you can, you know, say, wow, you know, point out the details. Mm-hmm. Wow, that the way you mix those colors, the way you blended, that's so interesting. Let's put it up on the refrigerator. That's beautiful. Because then the message you're sending is not, oh, you know, get addicted to my praise.
Right.
You know, just be addicted to my praise.
And overall praise, like, oh my God, you're the best.
Right.
That doesn't detail their effort.
Yeah, it doesn't detail, and it makes them, and it's actually pressure, because I mean, you think you know, you want to, you know,
make everything's got to be great.
I have to be the best, you know. Right. Oh, and what if I'm not the best?
Right.
So it's a little bit of pressure, as opposed to, wow, you're working hard on something.
Right.
And here we're going to appreciate you for it. And how do we help you continue to achieve your inner goals? So it's kind of a roundabout way of making your child, of sending that message that you were talking about.
Excellent. So getting into the theory that we wanted to talk about, and we had four things. And the first one was that when you are disciplining your child, you have to see yourself as a teacher. And that really, for me, always changed how I discipline my kids. Because it's no longer, listen, unfortunately, most discipline, I think, happens when you're about to, like, go nuts, right?
You're
screaming
your
again, and oh my gosh, right?
Yeah.
And instead, and that's not where you're going to teach the most. But if you say to yourself, you know something, I have an obligation to teach my child about discipline and to self-discipline. And it's hard, because I got to be honest with you, and you know me as a dad, I love the listening part of being a parent. I love the doing. I love the making happy. I love all that. I don't like the discipline part. I can't stand
it's
the
hard.
Discipline
it's,
part.
And discipline's a strong word, you know?
It is. And, listen, maybe some parents like discipline. I discipline their kids. I mean, I don't
parents
know.
I think parents get to the point where they, like, need, like, I want to punish. I need to
yes.
know what to do. It drives me crazy, because we
you say I want to punch?
No.
Oh, punish.
Okay. Let me clarify. Don't punch your kids.
Punish. Thank you.
Punish.
Making sure.
Okay, let me clarify. Let me not say. I was getting so excited. I kind of was like,
how do I do this?
Yeah. People get, you know, parents want, you know, they get to the end.
Yes.
Where they're just like, I need a fast, quick way to end this. As opposed to, I think your message, maybe to step back and say, this is a lifestyle choice. This
is
discipline is overall.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. It's an overall lifestyle choice. And as we're going to describe it, it's going to include discipline and action for negative things as much as action for positive things. It's a whole, you know, sense of that.
Yeah.
So the first thing you want to say when you're disciplining your child is, what am I teaching my child? When I'm doing whatever it is I'm doing, what am I teaching my child about the world? And we're gonna deal with that. And let's get to number two, and then we're gonna break, and we're gonna go hold over the rest for part two. The second thing is really teaching your kid to setting up for success. That you need
to
set your kid up for success. So many times, I think we end up disciplining our kids because our expectations of them are unrealistic. So if I'm taking my kid to a fancy restaurant where we're paying a lot of money and we're expected to sit there for 2 hours, and my six-year-old is not going to sit there for 2 hours like a perfect little puppet, you know, during dinner. And then you're going to be upset 45 minutes in
nicely,
or 25
yeah.
minutes in when they're jittery and whatever. So, you know, either figure out how that kid can make it there, or don't go there, because that's not the place. So the more we always want to make our children feel successful.
Right.
We want to make them work hard for their success, you know, but it's got to be reasonable. If it's working too hard, that's not reasonable. And then they feel like failures because they tried and they failed.
Right.
And we want to avoid that as well.
Right. We want to make them feel successful.
Exactly.
We want to teach them that. Right? It kind of blends together in a way, you know, because we want them to feel good about themselves, and we want them to think, we want to really think about how we're going to make them feel successful and kind of go from there.
Yeah. And when you feel successful, we talked about this in our marriage and appreciation. When you feel successful, what do? you continue
yes.
to behave in a way to try to yeah. please and be successful again. Yeah. Once you get in your head that you can't win and you're a failure, right. all of a sudden it's like, oh, can't right. do it.
And kids
can't
feel the same it. Way, just like your spouse might feel that way.
Exactly, yes.
But that brings us to a point about positivity. I think this is something that, until our next podcast this week, you guys can go home and really practice this, which is getting your child almost addicted to positive reinforcement.
Yes.
You know, catching them at the good things. You know, everyone wants to feel appreciated even for the things they're supposed to do. We've said this before. So positivity, you know, catching your kid, wow, you're speaking so softly. Mm-hmm. You know, when you say to your kid, when your kid's screaming, oh, mommy, mommy, daddy, daddy, and I know this all too well because I have a four-year-old who is so loving, but doesn't
terrific
know
kid.
He doesn't know the octave, right? No. So we have to teach him that we use our inner voices. But if I keep saying to him, don't scream, don't scream. You know, kids don't hear, they don't hear the word don't, and they just hear everything afterwards. So don't hit your sister.
Oh, that's interesting. So you're saying yeah. that a lot of times because you say it or so quickly. I think, I don't know
yeah.
why, but you're saying
right.
don't scream. They don't hear the
think
don't
about
so
it.
Much.
When we read, we you know, and I look,
right,
I, you
shift.
Know,
yeah.
I, so, this is what I've seen in my, yeah. in my practice, you know, when you say, don't yeah. scream so loud. First of all, your face is all squished up.
Right, of
and even if you say, don't scream so loud, they hear scream so loud, right? Yeah. Because by the time they're tuning in, they're hearing it. So what
so
we want to
say
is,
it?
Oh, you know, I think we speak softly inside.
Oh, I
right?
see.
We speak
oh,
softly.
I see. Oh, do the positive
yeah,
of
do
it.
The positive.
Yeah. Excellent.
And then catch them, and then this week, catch them being good. So when, if, whatever you want to achieve with them, if it's their homework, getting their homework done. So instead of focusing when they don't get their homework done, say, I can't believe you didn't get your homework done. I now got to call the teacher. You say, wow, I'm so proud of you got your homework done. Or
nice.
You come in and you see them trying to do their homework.
Yes.
This is always something that's really good. You see them for, even if it's a second, right? Even if they did it for 2 minutes.
Right.
Wow. Oh, that's so great you're doing your homework. Good job. Nicely done.
Right.
And then everyone wants to do more of what they feel appreciated
right.
for.
And have it fit. I like the way you did it, is that it wasn't like, wow, you're
no,
doing your
no,
homework.
No, no, no. You don't have to be
because
like.
Because they can pick up on false.
Yeah.
And
especially
disingenuous.
Kid who's doing their homework and
yeah.
you've yelled
just
at them
say,
17 times right. before. Now, to, you know, they're going to pick up
yeah.
on that. So
but you say it, you know, as it meets the situation. But I think that's great. Work this week on positivity and picking up on all the positive things your kid is doing and how often you
right.
can say, so nice that you're
yeah.
helping your sister. Could you please, you know, speak a little nicer rather
right.
than stop speaking, like, you know, that
yeah.
kind of thing.
Yeah.
That would be great. And then, you know, think about the examples we gave, write in, you know, if you'd like, email us with more examples, of course, and also what you think might be your answers to these questions about these discipline, and we'll try to share them with everyone, or
right.
we'll look at them.
So we're going to get to our second, you know, there's 4 points of discipline, so our next two will be in the following
We'll be in
podcast.
Part two, and then we'll get to those things. So thank you very much for joining us today. Hope it's been a lot of help and a lot of fun. It has been for us. So go to NeumanMethod.com, N-E-U-M-A-N Method.com. Find out more about our work. You know, download the book for free. And we so look forward to being back with you here next week.